Hello and welcome everyone to our session titled 5 years on, WASH4Work, Business Leadership and Setting the Next Agenda. I'm Kate Holm and I'm Chair of WASH4Work and in my day job work for WaterAid. It's hard to believe it, but 2021 marks 5 years since the launch of WASH4Work. The initiative, of course, is underpinned by the UN Declaration of Access to Water and Sanitation as a Basic Human Right. And WASH4Work was established based on the belief that business has a fundamental responsibility to ensure it delivers this right for its workers and that its operations don't negatively impact communities' rights. And as we know, at a global level, water access, sanitation and hygiene continue to be urgent challenges. But as well as being a human right, in the last 18 months, COVID has really highlighted the key risk to business continuity from the lack of access to water, sanitation and hygiene. The connections between access to wash with health, with livelihoods, with business continuity have become so clear. We've seen this driving new momentum for business action on wash, for companies' own operations and for those left most vulnerable in supply chains and communities. The WASH4Work initiative is the global platform convening leadership on business action in WASH, and we've seen our membership more than double in the last year. And WBCSD's WASH pledge, now supported by WASH4Work, where companies commit to WASH best practice, has grown to more than 300 corporate signatories. What we're seeing for the first time is the beginning of a critical mass in corporate leadership on WASH, demonstrating best practice, evolving the business case, and signalling that WASH has become business. So we've been through a relatively quick but significant period of change, and WASH now sits more firmly on the business agenda than ever before. So it's great to have you all here with us today as we continue on that journey. Can we move on to the agenda slide, please? Thank you. In the first part of today's session, we'll hear from WASH4Work members who will share their examples of business leadership on WASH and some of their key learnings. Then in the second part of our session, we'll move on to discuss responding to the global agenda on climate and that transition from awareness to resilience. And then finally, we'll be reflecting back on WASH4Work and what next for the coalition. On to the next slide, where, as you can see, we have lots of speakers today who will introduce as we go through, and they're all ready to share their experience and learnings. So I hope there's going to be something for everyone to take away. But please don't just leave it to the speakers. Do use the chat function throughout the session for any questions you have or any comments or reflections you'd like to make. We'd really love the chat box to be an interactive discussion. So if you see a question asked and you have some thoughts on the answer, please do share your ideas and get stuck into the discussion and bring in even more perspectives. So let's start the first part of the session by going to WASH4Work's Vice Chair, Michael Alexander from Diageo, who'll give you some of his reflections on the last 5 years.
Thank you, Kate. And if we could have the next slide, please, that'd be excellent. So actually, it's a real privilege to be able to just quickly reflect on the achievements of WASH4Work over the last 5 years. I think it's remarkable what's happened, as Kate referred to, and the speed of progress. I think if we reflect now on these 5 years, we've had, I think it's about 20 business leaders join the group, demonstrating best practice in WASH. And we've had, importantly, 14 global WASH expert organizations in the group as well. And in my view, and in many of you, this is absolutely unique forum, which has helped deliver so much in terms of WASH by business. And it is unique because it's combining those WASH experts with businesses that are investing in WASH. And if you look over the 5 years in the next slide, we can see what's been achieved over the span of the life of WASH4Work, if you like. You know, so development of tools, essential tools to help people deliver WASH. A big influence on the adoption of WASH is the fifth outcome in the AWS standard. Of course, the response to COVID and the advice and support to members and others during the COVID and continuing, and also the adoption of the pledge, which we'll hear more of in a minute. So it's really achieved an awful lot over the 5 years, and that's been, and most importantly, you might reflect, actually it's been delivering WASH to millions of people on the ground, which is obviously very important indeed. But of course, there's much more to do. And if I quickly reflect on where I think there's some progress to be made and some further energy and investment to be made, we all know we have to collaborate more to scale up the solutions and deployment of WASH. That's an absolute must. And we're absolutely committed to that as WASH4Work. We need an integrated approach, front and foremost at a catchment level, working collectively. Collective action is obviously absolutely essential to deliver what we need to deliver in the deployment of clean water, hygiene, and sanitation. And I think we need to develop a good shared understanding of how WASH fits into the water and climate resilience narrative. And I think we'll hear more about that later today, which is a great kind of next step, as it were, in terms of how WASH is perceived and how WASH can unlock the potential as we adapt to climate change. And I think finally, we also need to leverage business innovation more. So we've had lots of good expert advice and expert input from the WASH NGO experts, but we also need business to step up with innovation and help deliver good WASH outcomes. So overall, we can successfully say that WASH is now firmly part of the Water Stewardship Agenda. Your AWS, CEO, Water Mandate, CDP and others all recognising WASH as a fundamental part of water stewardship, which is a very important step. We have an effective corporate WASH and forum working between business and WASH NGOs. And we have a common understanding on a practical approach to deployment. And that's important for businesses, a practical approach to deployment. And we have to make sure that that practical approach is well informed by business and by NGOs to ensure that the outcomes are right. I think we're working on the business case for investment. We'll have a little bit more about that today. We need to further refine that, but there is a business case for investing in WASH. It's compelling and it needs to be disseminated, if you like, to get the solution at scale. I'm really, really delighted with the progress of the 5 years. An awful lot more to do, as we know, as we aim for SDG 6. The time isn't on our side. So I'd really encourage participation in WASH4Work and build on the success of the last 5 years. We'll now turn to some business leaders sharing their experience of WASH in their operations, in their supply chains, in their communities. Really important to hear from others, to bring to light, to bring colour and context and human touch to the WASH work that's going on by the members. And I think that's that'll be really interesting for those attending today. If we think about it, what we want, the questions we want to ask in this session are around what is best practice in WASH and business operations and supply chains and communities? So we'll hear what best practice is about. What is the business case for WASH and how is that evolving? How can businesses measure and report on the benefits of their WASH programs? So again, some great speakers today talking about that. And finally, their latest thinking and the impact of WASH on climate and water resilience. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Kate and just encourage those to engage and to contribute and to join, because this is an organization that is going places and we really, really want to get as many people involved and to contribute as possible. So thank you. Over to you, Kate.
Thanks, Michael. Now we're going to pass to Tom Williams from WBCSD, who's going to share some information with us about the transition of the WASH pledge to WASH4Work.
Hello everyone, great to connect with you today and contribute to the discussion. My name is Tom Williams and I am Director for Nature, Action and Water at the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. This is a great opportunity to take stock of where we are as it relates to corporate action for WASH and what the future holds. And I think the story of the WASH pledge is illuminating for this purpose. In 2013, WBCSD launched the WASH Pledge, which was the first global pledge for business to demonstrate their commitment to WASH in the workplace. This came 3 years after the UN General Assembly recognised the human right to water and sanitation. So many corporates were starting to look at WASH from a human rights perspective. And at this time, when we were in the MDG era, water and sanitation was largely about access. However, the water community were understanding that access to taps and toilets was not enough, and that we needed to ensure water supplies and hygiene and sanitation facilities were not only accessible, but also safe, affordable, and available. These dimensions were not only recognised in the Human Rights of Water and Sanitation, but also in the 2015 Sustainable Development Goals, and specifically SDG 6. And one successful outcome of the SDGs that has value to this day is it has oriented business action towards our most critical development needs. So with the SDGs and business aligning their strategies with them, water became a key development driver for business. In 2018, 5 years after launching the WASH Pledge, we took stock and published an impact report on progress to date. We had 47 companies signing the WASH Pledge, impacting over 2.4 million employees in 170 countries and close to 6,000 sites. In this impact report, which we presented at the 2018 UN High Level Political Forum, the foreword was written by CDP, who shared that in 2017, only 7% of corporates they surveyed had made commitments to improving access to WASH. So we still had some way to go in mainstreaming WASH and business practices. A big push in this direction came in 2019 with the launch of version 2 of the AWS standard, which recognized WASH as one of the 5 key outcomes, and you'll hear more about that later. This was an important step in codifying many of the WASH-related best practices, such as those promoted as part of the WASH Pledge within a broader water stewardship approach. Since launching the WASH Pledge, a number of companies have gone beyond the original scope that focused on owned operations and started to look at washing their supply chains and communities. And this signaled to us that corporates were willing and ready to go further. So we decided to update the WASH Pledge with this new scope and launch in 2020. Then COVID arrived. Hand washing and hygiene were top of mind. We saw huge disruptions to businesses, economies closed down and supply chains were impacted. Business continuity was severely compromised because of a public health emergency where WASH had a role to play. As we launched version 2 of the WASH Pledge in early 2020, we received high demand from companies to sign the WASH Pledge and adhere to best practices. They were seeing the critical need of having a voice and demonstrating leadership on good WASH practices in their workplace, in their communities, and with their suppliers. Today, I'm really delighted to say that we have 300 WASH Pledge signatories, a huge achievement. And we also recognize that the level of support required for knowledge, tools, and general support by the signatories is beyond the capacity of WBCSD. And it's for this reason that we are in the process of transitioning the WASH Pledge to be a WASH4Work led initiative. So signatories can tap into the vast support network that the WASH4Work partners bring. So the story of WASH Pledge is one that has moved with business action on WASH from companies fulfilling their human rights obligations to collective action with governments and civil society in recognizing water as a key development issue, and to today where we have recognition that inadequate and unsafe WASH facilities severely impacts business continuity. I'm really glad that WBCSD with its members has been a leader in this space, but I'm even more hopeful for the future in passing over the great momentum we have developed through the WASH Pledge to the WASH4Work initiative. Thanks for your time today. I hope you enjoy the rest of the session and really look forward to continuing to grow this momentum with the WASH4Work initiative in the future. Thank you.
Now we're going to hear from some of our members on the business action on WASH their companies have taken. So we'll start this with Dr. Rishikesh from Adita Birla Group, who will share actions they've taken on WASH within their operations. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Kit. And thanks for your time and opportunity given to me to share our experience and to interact with all of you. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm Dr. Rishikesh. I'm heading Integrated Health Services at Aditya Birla Group, based out of Mumbai, India. Next slide, please. Something about Aditya Birla Group. I would like next click, please. I don't know why it is animated, but then this is about Aditya Birla Group. I will just take 10 seconds. We are 48 billion MNC across 14 different industrial sector, manufacturing to service sectors. And then we are in 36 countries having 120,000 employees of 42 different nationalities. And we are playing major role in different industrial sector as it is mentioned. Next slide, please. With one more click, I'm sorry for this. So what happened that we have been doing something around WASH, largely focusing on local statutory requirement and the local practices. And we are sure that it was being done. But when we came across WBCST WASH pledge in 2014 and et cetera, we wanted to drive it very systematically across the group. And for that, when we went for approval to chairman office, actually we had a time of around 15-20 minutes to explain business case and why we require all these things. And actually we could finish up within 5 minutes saying that no discussion, this is a basic requirement. And now we have some the standards and the tool to measure our progress. We are going for it. And we are going for it without having a check on ROI or some employee satisfaction index or something, no impact assessment, just go for it and comply. So that's the kind of support right from the top we got. And but while driving it, we had many challenges like Aditya Birla Group locations are in different countries. We are in different kind of operation. We have locations with different strength across geographies, ethnicity. There is a difference in ethnicity, social practices there, religious practices. And but to cover everything, we require to have a good data accuracy, the good monitoring system where everybody will come on one platform, and we use WBCST tool to assess the compliance. And we wanted to have this centrally driven, but keeping its federal structure intake, because at the Billia Group, we have federal structure. And therefore, we came up with few solutions, and these were the enablers. So we first use information technology platform. We are having Enablon, which is helping us to see our sustainability report. So we developed some self-assessment tool there. And to explain people, we developed some training module, and there were structured way because we are in 14 sectors and multiple locations. So we had to have a structured approach. We had a three-level approach. At site level, there is a self-assessment. At business level, there is a review. At group level, there is a review. And then facilitation to implement the requirement of WASH pledge wherever it is not there. And not only that, it's only based on self-assessment or reviews. We had a separate assurance team to ensure that if we declare compliant, then it has to be compliant. And then there were separate auditors who were auditing it with a two-stage verification process. One is off-site and one is on-site. And based on their statistical data, we have also published assurance report along with our compliance report. So that is how we went through it. And we had a regular review committee in place. And we had a real good experience doing this. I'm sure that everybody would find this WASH pledge tool is very good. So where we can measure our compliance between the range of 0 to 2. Next slide, please. With one more click. So we signed the WASH pledge in January 2015. WASH pledge is there for 3 years. So our first cycle was from 2015 to 2018. During that, all those enablers were, we invested time to keep the enablers in place and then do assessment and then find out gaps and then complying with that gap. And we internally had a target of at least 90% of the WBCSD WASH pledge requirement. And we enrolled it over 243 sites. And in last 1 year where everything was in place, we could achieve 92.5% score, and it required around $2.87 million. But that we got easily. So during that time, our group was going in some changes. There were around 80 sites which get divested, 97 sites gets divested, 80 new sites came up. So we pick up the second phase starting from January 2018 to January 2021, where we have additional sites and we wanted to build upon what we have already achieved. So with all these changes and with all these enablers in place, we could achieve 96% compliance report, compliance, and it is along with assurance report. But as an experience, a very good, fantastic tool, a very good standard is there in place. We have to have this assessment, and particularly when I'm talking about a big size. And this is what we could do. There are 1765 new male uriners, you know, wherever there was this many things we could build. So nice experience. Thank you very much for all this tool, which gives us a very systematic approach. Going forward, we will continue supporting WASH pledge implementation to our business. But coming back to federal structure, probably now we have decided it is upon businesses to drive this on individual things, and we will continue providing technical support. And we are looking forward for WASH4Work initiative, and that is for sure. So that is from my side. It's from Aditya Builder Group. Thank you very much. Over to you, Kate.
Thank you, Dr. Rishikesh, for sharing that. And now we move from operations into supply chains, and we'll be hearing from Alison Gilbert at Gap Inc., who shares some of the actions that they've taken at Gap. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Alison Gilbert. I work on water stewardship at Gap Inc., which is the parent company to apparel brands Gap, Old Navy, Banana Republic, and Athleta. Before I jump into the details of what we have been doing around WASH through our USAID Gap Inc. Women in Water Alliance, I'll start with why we are focused on WASH and then dive into the how for how we've gone about creating impact along our supply chain. So first, the why. As a company, we see water fundamentally as a human right. We aim to improve and sustain the health and well-being of women and communities touched by the apparel industry. Our focus on women and water is connected to the fact that about 70% of people who make and produce clothing along the value chain are women, whether that's growing cotton or in the cut and sew process. And as many of you here at CEWE know, women are disproportionately impacted by water stress. So we oriented our WASH approach to focus on cotton and textile manufacturing communities. So that's the why. The how is we are partnering with US Agency for International Development, USAID, on a public-private partnership called the USAID Gap Inc. Women in Water Alliance. We are working with key NGOs in collective action approach in two states in India where cotton is grown and where textiles are manufactured. And we have a focus on women as change makers who are advancing their own WASH-related needs. The goal of this program is to empower 2 million people, of which 1 million are women, to improve their access to drinking water and sanitation by 2023. And as of 2020, we've empowered 640,000 people with that access to WASH. And it's important to acknowledge that COVID impacts were, of course, very top of mind throughout 2020 and 2021, where we were working in India. And we saw such focus around the world on the importance of hygiene. All of a sudden, hand washing was so top of mind for everyone who both had that access and did not. And it really underscored the importance of this type of work. And we also saw incredible displays of resilience among the field partners, our implementing staff, and the women in the communities where we were working. So that is kind of a through line from our experience in these last 2 years. Back to how the Women in Water Alliance works. What Gap Inc. brings to the table is funding in partnership with USAID, and we also serve as prime with close collaboration with our partners, taking a very multifaceted approach. For us, collective action is really key to scaling our impact. We are leveraging the complementary strengths of different partners and working through local systems, whether that's local women's networks, local governments, or financial services to advance water stewardship. So our first partner we are working with is CARE, who is delivering the Gap Inc. PACE program. That's Personal Advancement and Career Enhancement Program. That was originally developed for factory settings, but we have adapted it for the community context. It's a life skills training program that empowers women through training such as communications, financial literacy, decision making, as well as water education with a focus on sanitation and hygiene. The aim of this work is to catalyze women through that empowerment model and then be able to connect them to the interventions of our other water-related partners. Water Aid focuses on local water governance approach, which is all about building in long-term sustainable governance systems to provide communities with access to water by using a healthy dialogue where women are actively participating in the governance process as they develop village action plans. We also partner with water.org, leveraging the financing aspect of water and sanitation. About 99% of the people who take out financing for water sanitation needs are women, and they have an incredibly high repayment rate. And here the catalytic approach is all about the question of how can we build off the financial ecosystem to support water and sanitation in a long-lasting way. And finally, we're working with the Institute for Sustainable Communities, ISC, on water stewardship out in the fields. We are training cotton farmers in India to implement water stewardship best practices, including how to use less water in growing cotton, how to use less chemical fertilizers that would otherwise impact water quality. All of this contributes to that overall quality and quantity of water in these locations, which tend to be very water-stressed locations. So that partnership has been going on since 2017, and we're also really excited as we're looking what to do next. The program runs through early 2023, and we've been so excited to connect water stewardship with WASH, and now really layering in climate resilience, all to bring it under the umbrella of water resilience and climate resilient WASH for communities. We see a really strong need to work with the WASH4Work member coalition, as well as other like-minded companies who are looking to advance the agenda on WASH through corporate action, both through the WASH4Work coalition and through our membership with the Water Resilience Coalition. We see such potential for collective action here. And in this example of our work to date, we've really leveraged various strengths of our implementing NGO partners and USAID. And now we're thinking about what that looks like working with other corporate partners looking to advance similar objectives in the future. So we're really excited about what's to come next in terms of those connection points, what we can build, and how we'll do that together. Thank you so much.
And now we'll go to our final speaker in this first section, Helena Dollimore from Unilever, who will be sharing with us an example focusing now on local communities.
Core part of the company ever since then. As a purpose-led business, we believe in doing the right thing, not just in our internal operations. Thanks again to WASH4Work for convening us on such an important topic. I think all of us over the past year have been working extensively on WASH in light of the pandemic. And although it's a shame we're not all together in Sweden as we would normally be, it's always good to get together online and discuss these issues. You've asked me today to touch upon a little about how Unilever responded to COVID-19 and what we've been doing, building on our long legacy of working in hygiene and working in WASH over the past 18 months. As many of you will know, hygiene has been a central part of Unilever since we were founded as a purpose-led company. Our founder, William Lever, who was founded the company back in the 19th century, founded the company with a mission to make cleanliness commonplace. And our commitment to WASH has been a core part of the company ever since then. As a purpose-led business, we believe in doing the right thing, not just in our internal operations, but also throughout our entire sphere of influence, both from the internal operations and the supply chain, through to our value chain and the communities we serve, and also working increasingly through our brands like Persil, Dove, and Marmite to affect change and bring about change in the communities within which we work. We do that by running programs and initiatives in our own operations and in the communities where we are present to advance a number of areas. In WASH specifically, two of our brands, Domestos and Lifebuoy, work extensively on improving access to clean toilets and encouraging hand washing with soap. And they've done that for many years. So when COVID-19 struck last year, Unilever and our brands had a strong foundation on which to build from to address the shock of COVID-19 within our own operations and supply chains. And we also felt that we had a role to play in the wider world as well. So firstly, we moved very quickly to ensure the safety of our staff. We already have extensive WASH facilities available to all staff across Unilever's operations. But we also took a number of measures to keep people safe from COVID-19. The majority of our staff work in laboratories, factories and distribution centres, and we had a very clear protocol in place in those facilities to keep them safe. We also had a central resource of guidance and policies that was quickly and centrally managed with local adaptions, depending on the context and informed by the local pandemic situation. You can flick back to the first slide. So we also undertook a number of efforts to support our value chain, and we offered cash flow relief and early payment to some of the vulnerable small and medium sized enterprises that we work with and suppliers to help them during the COVID crisis and help them also keep their staff safe. And as you can imagine, the global market changed dramatically in response to COVID-19, and demand for hygiene products was as high as it's ever been. So our production teams had to move at speed to meet the scale of the demand. And we, as well as ramping up production in our own factories, we also switched several production lines over to produce more hygiene products and meet that global demand that was coming in and was really unprecedented. But as I mentioned at the start, as the world's largest soap company with such a strong heritage and expertise in hygiene behaviour change, we were also well placed to respond to the pandemic in the wider world and in the communities where we work. And we recognise that it's not just about doing what we can for our staff and our immediate supply chain, but also about making sure that people are safe from the pandemic in the homes and the communities that they go home to at the end of their working day. So knowing early on in the pandemic the importance of hand washing with soap to tackling COVID-19, which the WHO are still clear on to this day, we sought to do what we could to help those communities who were most at risk. And we set up the Hygiene and Behaviour Change Coalition at the start of the pandemic with the UK government. At the time it was DFID, the Department for International Development. It's now the FCDO, the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office. And we joined together in a £100 million partnership to reach some of the most vulnerable populations in low and middle income countries. And we set out really with three objectives. Number one, to make sure communities had the infrastructure that they needed: hand washing facilities, access to clean water, and access to hygiene products and soap to clean their hands. Number two, we made sure that they were aware of and educated on what they needed to do to keep themselves and their families safe. And we used all of the hygiene behaviour change tools we had at our disposal from years of learning in Unilever. And thirdly, we also wanted to make sure we prioritised vulnerable groups like health workers, refugees, people with disabilities, and also migrant workers who were at great risk of taking the virus out from urban areas to rural areas on their return home. So we had an ambitious target to reach 1 billion people. And if we move to the next slide, I'm pleased to show you that we've already reached over 1.4 billion people across 78 projects in 37 countries. And really the reason we've been launching this huge response to COVID-19 is not just the moral imperative and the reason that, you know, brings us all around the table at WASH4Work. We believe it's important to have WASH in supply chains and access to WASH. But also there's a business imperative. You know, we think it's bad for business to have continuing pockets of infection in COVID-19 around the world, the risk of new variants emerging, economies on constant lockdown. And we believe that no one is safe until we are all safe. And that's been the guiding objective of the Hygiene and Behaviour Change Coalition. Essential to helping us deliver the HBCC on the ground is the network of 21 NGO and UN partners that you see on the screen right now. And we also have an academic partner, the London School for Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, who have ensured our response has been driven by evidence as the pandemics evolved. Just to give you a few examples of what some of the partners have been doing on the ground, WaterAid have been working with experts to design hand washing facilities that can be used by people with disabilities, operated by a pedal, for example, using your feet. This also makes sure that people with disabilities are not left behind from some of the COVID-19 interventions that have taken place. We also delivered an unprecedented amount of hygiene products to our NGO partners across the whole of the world, and the donation that the UN Refugee Agency, UNHCR, received was the largest donation they've ever received in their history. UNHCR also worked with refugees in South Sudan and DRC to train them to be community health workers to deliver hygiene awareness messages in their camps. ActionAid worked with women and girls to empower them as COVID-19 change makers in their communities. And Sesame Workshop adapted Unilever behaviour change materials that we'd used through Lifebuoy and Domestos to make it accessible to children and their carers by using some of the well-known characters from Sesame Street. So this gives you an indication of the size and the scale of the HBCC. And really, we've got a few lessons for future. We would really encourage, you know, all businesses to, of course, prioritise washing your supply chain. If you don't see the importance of it today, as we're living through a global pandemic, I'm not sure when you will, but I would urge you that as we come out of the pandemic, don't relax those WASH measures, those WASH resources that you are providing in your supply chain and value chain, because we know that they are important for preventing the infectious diseases that many still die from and suffer from every year. And I would also urge that, you know, increasingly we're thinking about how to affect the systems change on WASH and hygiene. Unilever is doing all we can and we're stepping up, but we know that we can't achieve this alone and we can't reach SDG 6, that ambitious target that was set in 2015 to give everyone access to clean and safe water, sanitation and hygiene by 2030. We can't achieve that unless governments step up, national and local governments, and civil society. So we would particularly urge governments to make sure, even as we come out of COVID-19, the pandemic, and even as vaccination campaigns are picking up around the world, make sure that you're continuing to prioritise WASH, continuing to invest in that and making that a priority. Thank you.
Thanks to all of our speakers for sharing such tangible examples and learnings. Now we're going to move to the second part of our session on responding to the global agenda on WASH, moving from awareness to resilience. And for this, I'll pass to Jason Morrison from CEO Water Mandate and Water Resilience Coalition, who will introduce and guide us through this discussion. Over to you, Jason.
Great, thank you, Kate. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. It's great to be a part of this discussion. As Kate mentioned, we're going to now look toward the future of what WASH4Work will be looking to orient its consortium work around. And it's this idea that Michael alluded to, that business as usual for the way that companies think about WASH within their corporate water stewardship programs is likely going to need to evolve in the face of climate change. And the recognition that our current approach to investing in taps and toilets is likely not going to be resilient to the effects that climate change will have on water systems around the world. And there's a lot of innovative practice, and I want to talk about the agenda for this next session, if we can pull up that slide. But I also want to then come back a little bit and talk a bit about the opportunity for collective action on this. So the first two speakers we'll have are practitioners that are beginning to evolve their approaches. One, Virginia Newton-Lewis from WaterAid, and Fiona Ward from UNICEF to give their current thinking on this evolution towards resilient WASH. And then we're gonna hear from a number of WASH4Work member companies around projects that they have been implementing that are in essence WASH that has more of a resilience orientation inherently in the approach that they're doing. But before passing to my colleagues, I want to say a few words about the aforementioned Water Resilience Coalition and speak about it within the context of a great opportunity to connect companies that are making commitments around WASH and the opportunity to build off the expertise within the WASH4Work consortium. Next slide, please. For those unfamiliar with the Water Resilience Coalition, it is an initiative that was launched last year within the Sea Water Mandate. And one of the key elements about this initiative is both long-term commitments, quantifiable commitments, 2030 and 2050, both individually and collectively as a consortium, but also the notion of driving on-the-ground collective action efforts. And as Allison mentioned earlier, there's a real need as we move from WASH and the way that we think about company action on WASH that could be done unilaterally or maybe bilaterally. As we evolve toward resilience thinking, we need to take a systems approach, and that inherently will require collective action initiative and change at a systemic level. So this is the orientation of this consortium, but I also want to talk about something that Michael, next slide please, Michael also mentioned, which is the idea that WASH is now getting firmly embedded within a corporate water stewardship practice. And within the Water Resilience Coalition pledge, I'm going to talk about this first element of net positive water impact, because what it is entailing is the notion that companies in their places where they have operations that in water stressed regions, that they're going to try to have a positive impact on water availability, water quality, and accessibility. And so there's a real push now to try to make sure that the companies that are operating in areas where WASH is a significant challenge, that they are gonna orient their programs and their investments in addressing this issue. Next slide, please. The WRC has also set a collective ambition. So I don't have time to go through all of the data points here, but I wanna talk about the far right column and the commitment that the consortium has made to having a positive impact on WASH for over 100 million people by the year 2030. And in trying to achieve this goal, we are thinking squarely around climate resilient WASH. That is the ambition. And we are looking to work with organizations in all of the regions where the current work is landing, in five countries right now, in India and Brazil and South Africa, USA and Mexico. And so there's a great opportunity to collaborate with WASH4Work and WASH4Work partners on moving this forward. Next slide, please. So this is where we think these opportunities for collaboration exist. So first of all, we will hear now from the experts within WASH4Work around how they are thinking about resilient WASH. How do you measure it? And how do you define it? What are the impact metrics that we'll use as we're trying to have impact at scale? We also want to bring this issue of WASH and the expertise in the network to a higher level, to more companies within the community. And then lastly, the idea of really bringing the WASH4Work members' expertise on climate resilient WASH to the collective actions that are happening in these regions of shared interest. So a great opportunity as we move forward to really collaborate around on the ground action on resilient WASH. So that I wanted to make sure people are aware of the opportunities to collaborate between WASH4Work and WRC. And I'm now gonna hand over to our colleagues to talk a little bit about the innovations they're doing about WASH and climate resilience.
Hello, everybody. My name is Virginia Newton-Lewis from WaterAid, and I'm going to spend the next few moments talking to you about climate resilience and what that really means. Next slide, please. So one barrier to progressing work on WASH and climate resilience is that it can be a little bit confusing to understand exactly what it is that we're talking about. This is because there are several definitions of resilience, and we can be referring to different things within the WASH system when we're talking about building resilience. So for example, in WaterAid, we could be talking about at least two different things when we talk about WASH and resilience in relation to climate change. Firstly, the increased climate resilience that access to WASH itself confers, or secondly, the resilience of the WASH services and behaviours themselves. One simple way to unpack this is to ask some basic framing questions, i.e. the resilience of what, for whom, and to what, And a recent paper from Kat Gresham at the University of Oxford has done exactly this, and I'll pop that in the chat in a moment. And if we want to get even more granular, we can also start to ask, what type of resilience do we mean? For example, do we want resilience to be around adapting, recovering, reorienting? So to keep it simple on this slide, the answer to our question, resilience of what to what, needs to be explicitly addressed to support good design and effective programming. So the take-home message is to devote some thinking time to unpacking what you mean by resilience. Next slide, please. This slide really highlights the idea of community resilience. The key point that we want the wider business and water community to champion is that access to WASH confers a level of climate resilience and is therefore an intervention that supports wider efforts towards adaptation. This is because, for example, water, sanitation and hygiene services and behaviours reduce the overall disease burden that you may experience during climate impacts like flooding. Safely managed sanitation and improved hygiene reduce the risk of water supply contamination and further mitigate risks of knock-on health crises. Water supply services in and of themselves increase the amount of clean water people have in climate in times of scarcity. So access to WASH confers a level of resilience to communities. Next slide, please. The term climate resilience is also linked to the concept of resilient WASH systems. We want to see these WASH systems continue to deliver benefits or be rapidly restored despite climate-induced hazards. Given that we are all operating in an era of climate change, climate resilient WASH must be a standard consideration in all of our programming work. When exploring what climate resilient WASH means, though, we need to make sure that we focus on much more than just technologies, which tend to kind of take a lot of the headlines. Instead, we need to see inclusive, risk-based planning focused on addressing inequalities, development of appropriate coping strategies, and implementation of high-quality, robust options. And really, the key point is the strengthening of WASH systems. So my take-home message on this slide is to make sure that you're looking beyond the tech. Climate resilience means considering the whole WASH system and maintaining climate change interventions in wider programming and system strengthening approaches. Last slide, please. Thank you. And this final slide shows you just one example of the types of intervention that we're talking about when we discuss climate resilient WASH. You can see in front of you an example from our work in West Africa, which we call the Securing Water Resources approach. It's based on community actions to understand and manage risks in project areas of Burkina Faso and Ghana. And it's based on some simple steps. And our experience with this is that it has been successful in helping communities manage access to WASH through the dry season. But WaterAid has also been working on several other types of climate resilient WASH intervention, ranging from working in schools and communities to increase water availability and sustainability through, for example, rainwater harvesting in Mozambique and demonstrating WASH delivery models in selected schools in Bangladesh. And I'm happy to discuss that more in the chat if you like. Thank you very much.
Great, and I believe we're gonna go straight from to Fiona Ward's remarks. Are we having challenges queuing Fiona's video? Here we go.
Great. Hi there. And first of all, thanks very much for this fantastic opportunity. Just to say that I've learned a lot. I was scribbling madly at some of the initiatives which are being undertaken, which is really fantastic to hear about. And I've learned a lot. But just to say, I mean, in terms of what was highlighted as the core elements, we'd like to contribute to that, but also to say that UNICEF has also ourselves really spent a lot of time trying to define what is climate resilience, especially for our WASH systems. But just before we go into that, just to highlight that UNICEF has recently just launched a Water Security for All initiative. Our research highlighted that 450 million children are living in areas that are of high and extremely high water vulnerability. As we've heard from the previous presenters, we all know what this means in terms of not just livelihoods, but it also means in terms of children's access to education, and whether they have to drop out, especially girls. It also affects children's nutrition, children's health, and also livelihoods, and of course in terms of the role of women and girls in communities. So just to say that this is a really large thing. But for us, it's not just looking at access. And if you could move to the next slide, please. For us, it's not, I think as we heard from Tom also, we've moved away from talking about access to wash facilities to ensuring that we're talking about climate resilient. So for us, it's not just providing interventions which increase the access, maybe going from a hand pump to a motorized system, but it's really ensuring that those systems are climate resilient. It's as we've heard from Ravash about the work in South Africa, it's not just a matter of, you know, having water in the network, it's how do you make sure that that water is used as efficiently as possible. So as part of our work to ensure that our systems are climate resilient, we really do undertake a very comprehensive climate risk analysis. We look at different technical solutions, and this looks, in addition to what we've heard like from Ravash, it's not just looking at how do you conserve the water in the system, but also how can you, for example, look at alternative sources of water? What can we do with reuse? How do we ensure that we're not making a situation worse, so that if we're drilling a borehole, that we undertake a comprehensive risk analysis of the water resources available? And importantly, that we're transitioning to renewable energy, but also in terms of ensuring that there's opportunities that when the wash sector is looking at how to become climate resilient, that we're looking at a whole range of opportunities to leverage financing. Next slide, please. So in terms of what we are doing, UNICEF is transitioning to ensure that all of our WASH results are climate resilient by the end of this year. I think last year we provided climate resilient WASH water services to over 6 million people. And as I mentioned, we're talking about undertaking large scale resource assessments, looking at how much water there is, what is the quality, and importantly, what are the future projections for water, and what are we doing to ensure that that water is used as efficiently as possible, but importantly, that there's a sense of value of water. So we're not just going from providing what perhaps was beforehand a hand pump, but importantly, ensuring that as we improve the level of service, that service is going to be sustainable in terms of water resources, but also in terms of the operation. We're also just looking at multi-use schemes where we install a solar system, and this has multiple water points, and these water points really help save the amount of time, as we've heard, save the amount of time which is required to collect water, but increases the volume, but ensuring also that we're not contributing to water depletion. But importantly, these systems also ensure that people have enough water to be able to tend farms, for example, or to create other livelihood opportunities, which means that the household income increases, and that has, of course, outcomes in terms of education and health, as well as reducing the potential for conflict, as well as migration. Also importantly, what we're doing is in terms of capacity building of the sector, really helping the sector, the WASH sector, in terms of identifying the climate risks, but also new innovative climatic solutions. And I think last year we installed about over 1,400 solar powered water systems, not just in communities, but also in schools and healthcare facilities, because this is really important. As we've seen with some of our systems, for example, we had some systems in Mozambique that after Cyclone Idai came across, actually our systems, which we had just transitioned to solar, were actually functional and immediately after the cyclone. But importantly, they became hubs so that people who were depending on electricity for their sources, or they were looking at different other sources, then came to our point. So that really helped in terms of the climate resilience. And we have a technical hub in Western Central Africa, which is doing capacity building in French and English on different aspects of the design. And just my last slide, please. So just in terms of, I've heard a lot today about what different companies have been doing, which is really fantastic, but it's also just really just looking at it's not just looking at the water efficiency, and it's great to hear that Coca-Cola, for example, replenished 170% of the water resources, but it's also what can be done, what can be continuously done in terms of looking at the efficiency of the businesses, but also how do you create a demand for climate resilient water services. And then also that and then we've heard about lots of the programs which are being supported, but also how do you ensure that whatever programs you are supporting are climate resilient? And that's perhaps the last ask we have. And in terms of the suggestions for the core elements, that they are there, but also that they're climate resilient. So thank you very much for your time. Thanks.
Hello, and I'm aware we're running a little bit short on time, so I think what we're going to do is we will run the next two videos through the files so that you don't miss out on the examples from companies, and so we'll get those available to you, and we'll just close now before we run out entirely. So we'll be hearing from those two separately. We'll make sure we get them to you. So just a few comments to close, really. We've heard a lot both today and already this week about the importance of collaboration. And of course, 5 years after our initial launch, that's still what WASH4Work is all about. We're always keen to welcome new members, business and non-business. So whether you're well established in your WASH journey or you're just starting to think about your first steps, we hope you'll consider joining and taking advantage of the wealth of knowledge within the coalition as we work together to continue driving forward thought leadership in this area. So do stay tuned for announcements about the evolution of our future work programme. Lots of exciting things coming up. Of course, if membership isn't for you right now, our website is full of tools and guidance. So please do go online and see if there's something on there which might help you with your next step. So thank you everyone for joining us today. I hope there's been something for you to take away and find useful as you move forward in your journey. Thank you.